are using Rite 1 today, as we said we would do every time there is a fifth Sunday of the month, and this is the fifth Sunday of the month. Rite 1 begins on page 323 in the Offertory. Blessed is God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever.
Security, each of you in the house of your, they wept aloud. They said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Do I still have sons in my womb, that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. Even if I thought there was hope for me, even if I should have a husband tonight and bear sons, would you then wait until they were grown? Would you then refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, it has been far more bitter for me than for you, because the hand of the Lord has turned against me." Then they wept aloud again. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. So she said, "See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not press me to leave you or to turn back and follow you. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. There I will be buried. May the Lord do thus and so to me, and more as well, even if death parts me from you." When Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more to her. Hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Since we won't have the end of that story next week with our readings for your All Saints Day, let me just point out one very important thing. The story of Ruth, this charming story, as Janet said, ends with a line that says that Ruth was the ancestor of Jesse, who was the father of David. And that has a very important message because David was descended from a Moabite, a foreigner. And so much for the racial purity of anybody or anyone, anywhere. This story just kind of undermines it by pointing out that David's ancestor was a Moabite.
Let us pray Psalms 146, responsibly dividing it to half verse. The psalm is printed in the bulletin. Hallelujah, praise the Lord, O my soul.
I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God, all I am indeed.
Put not your trust in rulers, nor in any child of earth.
For there is no help in them.
When they breathe their last, they return to earth.
And in that day, their thoughts perish.
Happy are they who have the God of Jacob for their help.
Whose hope is in the Lord their God.
Who made heaven and earth, the seas, and all that is in them.
Who keeps his promise forever.
Who gives justice to those who are oppressed.
And good to those who hunger.
The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind.
The Lord sets the those who are bowed down.
The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord cares for the stranger.
He sustains the orphan and the widow, but thou frustrates the way of the wicked.
The Lord shall reign forever.
You are God of mine, throughout all generations. Hallelujah.
In our second reading, the author of the letter to the Hebrews tells us that the blood of Christ is a perfect sanctification for God's people. A reading from Hebrews 9:11-14. But when Christ came as the high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, he entered once for all into the holy place, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls, with the sprinkling of the ashes of heifer, sanctify those who have been defiled so that their flesh is purified, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to worship the living God? Hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to God's people.
Tenants who worked the land, And he sent to those tenants to get the produce from the land, his share of the earnings. They beat one, they killed another one, and finally he sent his son, and they killed him also. And suddenly the religious officials realized that Jesus was telling a story about them. And they were really furious then. But then the arguments continued. First of all, some came arguing about the law, but they were really just arguing in order to try to trap Jesus. They asked, is it legal to pay taxes to the governor? The government? They were just trying to trap Jesus. You remember what he said. Then others came asking about marriage in the resurrected life. And again, they wanted to know what the law said, testing Jesus. That's the background. And hearing all of this petty and deceitful arguing, a scribe, and the scribe was a teacher of the law, came to Jesus and asked a key question. Teacher, which is the most important commandment of all? And he asked not to argue further, but to end the argument. And Jesus gave that beloved statement that you just heard in the gospel reading. The summary of the law, the Shema in Israel to this day, meaning hear, O Israel. The Lord our God is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Jesus wasn't giving anything new. It was old material that he was just reciting. It goes back to the book of Deuteronomy, the Torah, and Leviticus. From centuries earlier, it was stating that these two laws override the over 600 laws that Judaism had, that there were really only two. Love God with all of you, every single bit of you, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. But there really is a third step that Jesus doesn't state, but he almost doesn't have to, because he stated it elsewhere, and that third step, or really the second step between loving God and loving your neighbor, is to love yourself. Some would say that that's selfish, that it just leads to sin. Others would say it's egotistical or narcissistic, but look at the scriptures. Beginning right in the very first of the scriptures with the story of creation, where human beings, humankind, are created in the image of God. That there is in every one of us this spark of the divine. And it leaves us not captives of that spark of the divine, but always with the freedom to choose, even to differ with that spark of the divine. And so the point was that we were to love this God who has created us in God's very own image. But there's kind of a natural progression for what happens. Being human beings, we tend to love God for what we can get out of God. Hey God, what's in it for me? It's a natural human reaction. If I follow you, God, what will you give me? And there's nothing wrong with that. It's the way we were created. But then, seeing what God does for us, we begin to love God for who God is. And having loved God for who God is, we begin to understand that we are God's beloved people. And loving God for what I can get out of God moves on to loving God for God's sake, and then finally loving myself for God's sake. It's full circle, going right back to that story of creation that created himself. And it's central to all human understanding of our life with God, the journey that human beings take with their God. But being human beings, we tend to forget. But God never forgets, and God never gives up on us. And the great good news for Christianity is that when we had fallen far from God and forgotten what God had done for us, God sent Jesus into our midst. And Jesus had much to say. In the beginning of John's Gospel, we're told that he came to his own people, and his own people didn't receive him, but to all who received him, he gave power to become the children of God. Again, full circle, back to that created image of God. And then Jesus gave people what he called a new commandment. It wasn't really all that new. It was to love your neighbor as you love yourself. It's the old summary of the law all over again. And Jesus said, I give you a new commandment that you love one another. Now, one of the truths is that no one can command love. I couldn't command Carol to love me 60 years ago, any more than Carol could command me to love her. It was the experience of living with one another, being with one another, in one another's presence, that we learned to love one another. But it grew out of our experience. It can't be commanded. Experience leads to love. There are those in our world who would say that the way to love is through fear. The beginning of wisdom, we read in Scripture, is fear of the Lord. But what they were really talking about was awe, not fear. Awe, that feeling of wow when we look at what God is doing in our lives, in God's world. Not a fear. Fear never promotes love. Instead, awe promotes love. But some Christian groups would still say that the way is through fear. It doesn't work. What does work is in the example that Jesus gives us. It's an example and a guide. Jesus said elsewhere in John's Gospel, just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. Just as. That's the example that Jesus gives us. An example of a deep love that we are to use in our lives in responding to our neighbors. It's a guide that Jesus gives us. Elsewhere, Jesus said, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. And that's the guide to human love of those who follow Jesus. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. The love that God has for us, Jesus was saying, is exactly the same love that God the Father had for Jesus the Christ, whom he set among us, that we might know God's love. And Jesus went on to say, abide in that love. Abide. Live into it. Live into it as fully as you can. This same love that God has for Jesus is the love God has for you. Live into it. Embrace it. Revel in it. Enjoy it. And again, it's full circle back to that created image of God. Created in God's image with that spark of the divine with us. And that's the story. Love God with every single bit of you. Love your neighbor just as you love yourself. But human beings have another question, and Luke's gospel records that other question that was asked. When Luke tells the same story of this scribe coming up and asking this question, which command is the greatest of all? Luke has that scribe, that lawyer in this case, saying, and who is my neighbor? Remember? And Jesus tells a story. Again, a rich story. It's a story that we know as the parable of the Good Samaritan, with similar religious figures as those who were arguing with Jesus, passing by a man who had been beaten by robbers and left on the road to bleed and suffer. And not one, but two religious officials came by, and they got as far from the other man as that trail would allow, and passed by and went on their way, and gave no help whatsoever. Not one, but two religious officials. And then a third man came along, a foreigner. He had a different background, a different name. He was from a group of people who were spurned by people like Jesus. And he took care of that man who had been wounded. Not only bandaged his wounds there, but took him to an inn riding on his own beast of burden. And he paid the people in the inn to take care of him until he returned again. And then he said, if there were more expenses, he'd pay them. And Jesus asked the man, the lawyer, which one of those was neighbor to the wounded man? And you know the answer, the one who helped. And it's the story for us. Not only are we to revel in the love that God has for us, celebrate it, enjoy it, to know we are created in love, an unconditional, eternal, priceless love that is ours, that we are in turn then to take that love and love the neighbor, especially a neighbor who is very different from us, who we might call a foreigner, who doesn't have much at all in common with us, but it doesn't matter, because this is another child of God who is neighbor to us. And we are to love, and love, and love, and love. Responding to God's call to love, let us join together in the Nicene Creed using the version in the prayer book beginning on page 326. We believe in one God,
Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father.
Especially the Episcopal Anglican province of Alexandria in our Anglican cycle of prayer. Our companion diocese, Brasilia, and their Bishop Mauricio, Bor and the Sudan and their Bishop Ruben, the people of Haiti and their Bishop Sachet, and grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Michael, our presiding bishop, Jennifer, our bishop, Bill, our priest in charge, our diocese partners, All Saints Indianapolis, the Reverend Sam Gott, and to all the baptized, that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, especially to this congregation here present, for Trinity Parish on our daily prayer list, and those who celebrate birthdays or anniversaries this week, including Denise Foley on November 3rd and Dennis McPherson on November 11th. That with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving me in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. Lord, in your mercy, we beseech thee also to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, especially Joe, our president, Eric, our governor, Tom, our mayor, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to
that rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And we humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor those who are hospitalized, including Michael Hervey, those in convalescent centers, Judith Austin, Teddy Fava, Sonia Hurley, Candy McPherson, Barbara Moffett, Elva Mullen, Carol Smalley. Our men and women of the armed forces, Audrey McMillan Cole, Chastain Gardner, Jessica Halliday, Brandon Hollowell, Greg Chaz Hewlett, Micah Jones, Chris Call, Brian Casper, Amanda Conover McAllister, Melissa Payne, Nathan Payne, Reed Bradslip, Travis Reed, Allison Woodruff, Ethan Loesch, Zach Webb. Those who work to protect us, including the police, firefighters, and emergency personnel in our communities, and those on our printed prayer list, and all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Lord, in your mercy, let us offer intercessions or thanksgivings, either silently or aloud, especially remembering today Chris Hoyle is hospitalized. The repose of the soul of Roger Saylor Sr., Brian Gregory's daughter's father-in-law, and Galen and Poor B. Patel and their three-week-old son, Rohan, James and Irene Alexander's grandson, who has been diagnosed with a heart valve problem.
For Heather Cottle, who is hospitalized. Continuing on page 330. He who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and make your humble confession as you are able, devoutly kneeling, and joining with me. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against thee in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved thee with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you and me. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. My sisters and brothers, the peace of the Lord is always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Let us, with gladness, present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to God. Right and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places Give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God, Creator of the light and source of life, who has made us in thine image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heavenly earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord most high. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself, once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel to command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you shall drink it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make. Having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify these gifts of bread and wine with thy word and Holy Spirit, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of this passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, humbly beseeching thee that we and all those who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ, our Lord. by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven,
Thank you. page 339. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank Thee for the Thou dost feed us in these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of Thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby that Thy liberty and grace for us, and that we are very ready to support it. Peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Support for the items in our budget. Pledges can be increased
or decreased or even canceled at any time. And your pledge allows the vestry to create the budget, both for the church in general and for outreach. So you'll see on the pledge card that there is a pledge or expected giving for outreach, especially the Wednesday lunch program. So I'll be at the door with the pledge cards, and we hope that you will prayerfully fill those out and get those back to us. Thanks.
The November newsletter is also in the box outside on the table. With thanks to the efforts of Sandy Guerin. Where is Sandy? She's in the back. Sandy is our editor for the newsletter. Does a wonderful job with that. I hope you will all pick up your copy of the newsletter. Are there other announcements? James?
Yeah, we'll continue to feed between 50 and 60 people on Wednesday, which is really good. We have some money preserved, thanks to the congregation, appreciate that. I did get the first payment on a book, I bombed. That's the way the cookie crumbles. But I want to say, when we get the hot, we're going to start doing something with hot meal, probably not coming inside, but giving them out. And that will considerably crank up our cost, I am sure. Thank you all for giving. We appreciate it very much. I think it's going very well. I don't know if you that take on it, but I do, certainly so.
And when we begin hot meals, there will be still takeout meals. We still do not feel it is a good experience to bring people into a crowded parish hall, and we don't know who's ill and who's vaccinated and who's not. So they will be takeout meals in takeout containers, and as James said, that will increase the cost of our meals. Steve?
Just a little update. So Tuesday morning, representative from the an elevator company. It's the same one that's in Cincinnati, but this is an Indianapolis office. It'll be here Tuesday morning to look at and assess what we need.
That's for the elevator that's out here in the hallway that is presently inoperable, and we really desperately need it for people who can't get up the steps otherwise. So, other announcements?
Candy.
No, I
didn't hear what
you said. Oh, somebody will be here Tuesday to give us an evaluation on replacing the elevator. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us go in peace, rejoicing in the power of God's presence with us.
Thanks be to God.